Tunable filter, one of the instruments, so I sort of add on to what Thomas talked earlier today. And some of you may have seen that picture on top, yeah, and recognize what it is nowadays. Yeah? It has grown quite a bit, yeah? Yeah, didn't it? Yeah, a couple of years ago, I was in London to a meeting, actually about DKIST, yeah? And we drove by a park, and I saw that monument, and I think that's a good thing to symbolize the VTF, yeah? An elephant standing on its trunk, something which is impossible or difficult to realize. Yeah? And by the way, the elephant is also a good measure for the mass and the size of the VTF. Yeah? Well, and not so big elephant like this one, which is a baby elephant. Yeah, I had a choice, yeah, for my talk, yeah, to be very superficial about the VTF or very incomplete. I chose a combination of both. Yeah? So it suffers from both. Yeah? Otherwise, it would be too long or too boring. Yeah, so we'll talk about, I try to bring all of you on the same page. So we'll talk about the question, what is a tunable filter? Because not everybody is an expert in that field. Yeah? I mentioned, talk a little bit about science with the VTF. Yeah? And yes, you can recognize the citation. You can't always get what you want. It's actually from 1969. Yeah? Most of you will know who said that, yeah, in 69. And the sun is the limit also for our instrument, yeah, and as you will see in a while. I will mention a few challenges and also solutions, yeah, just to give credit to the VTF team who are working very hard since the years in Freiburg, yeah, actually, yeah, to solve problems, yeah, and to meet the challenges. Yeah. And I say a few words about operational aspects of concerning the VTF. On the right-hand side, you see just the optical setup, yeah, without any hardware. Yeah. So the light is coming from the left, yeah, and goes zigzag back and forth and up and down, yeah, for a number of reasons. And a nice byproduct of that specific setup is that the 10 reflections that you can see if you count there are polarimetrically compensated. So the instrument is polarimetrically a benign instrument, yeah, with no intrinsic or very low intrinsic polarization, which is maybe not really important, but it's good to have that, yeah, property too. A few words about the instrument. It does provide diffraction-limited imaging, which has consequences for the design. It has a rather large wavelength range, yeah, from the green to the near infrared. Yeah. The field of view is what I call a large field of view, nearly one arc minute. And we had many discussions, yeah, in the early years of the project. Yeah. I remember discussions with a person named Bala, the NSO, know him very well. And his perception of a large field of view and my perception of a large field of view were quite different. Yeah. And so by nearly one order of magnitude. Yeah. And so this is why we ended up at one arc minute across. Yeah. And now, in retrospective, I wish I would have been much tougher on that, yeah, to get a smaller field of view for our instrument. But this is how it is. And it's quite photon efficient. We can do very fast spectroscopy, and we will try to do very precise polarimetry. And it's a very flexible and versatile instrument. Now I start with a basic picture. Yeah? You see here the transmission curves of two Fabry-Perot interferometers. Yeah? In this project, we used to call them etalon, yeah? Which is by definition wrong, yeah? Because an etalon is a Fabry-Perot interferometer, but a non-tunable one, yeah? Because it's used as a metrology standard. Yeah? So it's by definition non-tunable. But the word is easy to say, yeah? It's shorter than Fabry-Perot interferometer. So this is why people use etalon, yeah? Knowing that we don't have etalons, we have tunable Fabry-Perots. Yeah? And each of these Fabry-Perots produce what we call a channel spectrum of the transmission peaks, many, many transmission peaks. And if the if you employ a different VPRO, you have fewer transmission peaks at a different separation, and they are not quite as narrow as the one in the top row. And if you combine both in the optical beam, you get what you see in the lower graph. You get, whoops. Oh, I'm doing the wrong thing. Sorry. You have very few transmission peaks, and this is what you want. Yeah? The only thing that you need in addition, you put a pre-filter to suppress all the all but one of the large red transmission peaks. In case of the VTF, yeah, we'll start out with one of the two etalons, yeah? The top one, unfortunately. And that means we need really very narrow pre-filters to suppress all but one of the transmission peaks. That's the reason why I showed that. And this is just how it works. Yeah? You see the in the graph the spectral line. This is by the infrared calcium line. And you see the blue transmission peak. That's the wanted transmission peak of the instrument. And what you do, you change your VPRO slightly so that this transmission peak walks back and forth across the line. And you see on the left, you see that in the wing of the calcium line, oops, I made it again. I'm not the first one. You see in the wing, you have the photosphere nearly, not quite. And in the line core, you see nicely the chromospheric behavior of the solar atmosphere. And this now is an example. Yeah? This was courtesy of Eamon Scullion from Newcastle, who gave that movie to me. Actually, it works. Yeah? And you see the calcium line in the top right. Yeah? And there you see also a thin vertical line, which indicates the wavelength position during the scanning. And on the left, you see intensity images here from the wing, from the photosphere, up, down in the line core, up in the chromosphere. And that continues. This data has been taken many years ago at the Swedish Solar Telescope with the CRISP instrument. I show it just because it's a very nice example of how such an instrument works. one more slide about the working principle. Here now we have a photospheric line in the green, and we sample that line with 10 or 12, at 10 or 12 wavelength positions, shown here are 12. And at each wavelength position, we take, for a Stokes data set, four polarization states. Yeah? These are mixed states, yeah, which you can use then to calculate Stokes IQ, U, and V. So we could measure IQ, U, and V, but then you need more than four states. Yeah? So it's four. And we repeat that. It's called acquisitions in that graph a few times to get enough photons. So one data set would not be enough. There are just not enough photons to get a decent signal-to-noise ratio. And this is the basic thing you need. First place, you need enough photons. And then you need a good calibration, but you need enough photons. Without sufficient photons, it's worth nothing. And so we repeat that, say, eight times, typically. And we do that at each of these 12 wavelength points. Yeah? And so 8 times 4 times 12 is 384 images. And this is what we call one Stokes spectrum. Consists of 384 images. Each image has 4,000 by 4,000 pixels. Yeah? And it takes about 12 seconds to do that. So it's what I would call fast. Not everybody will agree. Somebody says, oh, it's too slow. We need 5 seconds or two. But I will say that again, the sun is the limit, yeah? Not our camera, not the detectors. Yeah. The instrument science requirements, this is the biggest hurdle for the instrument makers. And it has been my job for the last 10 years, yeah, to balance the interests of the science group with the instrument builder, so that actually these requirements are met. There is three columns here. Left is the requirements, yeah, as listed in the document. Then I have a two echelon configuration and a one echelon configuration. The column to the right is the first light instrument that will be delivered soon to Ali Akala. And 1 year later or so, we'll upgrade the instrument with the second echelon, which is presently being developed at industry. So in the first version, the wavelength range is a little bit smaller than in the final one. Yeah? I highlighted in yellow those requirements which are affected. And those which are not highlighted are actually not affected from this single echelon configuration. So the biggest effect comes from this ultra narrow band pre-filter, which cost light. They have less transmission. And so this, and you can't get them. Well, you could perhaps, but the price increases non-linearly with decreasing wavelength. Yeah? This is why we start at 590 nanometers instead of 520. It's expensive enough. Yeah? And they have less transmission, and so the signal-to-noise ratio. To achieve the same signal-to-noise ratio of 700, we have to integrate more often. And one thing that is heavily affected is the wavelength scan range, yeah, which is normally about 5 angstrom, half a nanometer. This is at the bottom. But with only one echelon, it's only 0.15 nanometers. Yeah, and that limits the Doppler velocities that we can measure. And for the photosphere, that's not a problem, because rarely you see something which is supersonic. So 10 kilometers per second would be enough for the photosphere. But in the chromosphere, you expect, and we know that there is higher velocities up to 100 kilometers per second. These will not easily be measurable with the first light version of the instrument, but easily with the second version of the instrument. That's the bottom line. For reasons nobody understands, that scan range was never mentioned in the science requirements documentation. Also, it's important. Yeah, now I could present you a long list of science cases with DKIST and with the VTF, yeah? But I will not do so, because you probably know you have what kind of science can be done or is expected to be done with a 4-meter telescope, with a what I call a microscope on the sun, yeah, which is capable to do sub arc second stuff. Instead, I encourage you to go to this critical science plan web pages. There you find all these 250 science use cases, which have been developed not by me, but by hundreds of colleagues, yeah, all over the world, in a series of workshops conducted in 2018 and 19. And a very interesting collection of excellent ideas, yeah, what to do with the DKIST, yeah, and the 5 instruments, yeah, and where VTF is just one of these. Yeah. Roughly half of the science use cases actually use the VTF. But in most cases, the VTF is not the only instrument. Also, it could be the only instrument. Yeah? And interestingly, most of these use cases plan to use the full spatial resolution. Yeah? So no spatial binning, no. Now we have a 4-meter telescope. Now we not want to know it. Yeah? What's down there below a tenth of an arc second? Actually, we do have a pixel size of 10 kilometers on the sun. Yeah? Which is really, really small. And on the other hand, about half of all the proposals want to observe in the chromosphere, where probably the 10-kilometer pixel size doesn't play that decisive role, at least, or you cannot have it, because you will need the photons again. Yeah? There's much less photons up there. And there is also many sunspot proposals. And these are the optimistic people. And I think the sun is just waiting for the VTF. We have the right field of view. And so the VTF, and it's also good for sunrise. Yeah? So in 2022, yeah, we'll have sunspots again. Yeah? We have another deep minimum right now. Yeah? Let's be optimistic on that. Yeah, I have to say that the VTF is actually two instruments. It is the dual beam spectropolarimeter, and it is a broadband imager. The broadband imager is needed. It's part of the instrument because you need it for co-registration. You have seen in the movie this, the scenery changes with height in the atmosphere, so you cannot easily connect these pictures. This is why you need photospheric context. Yeah? So this is an integral part of the VTF, but it is a context imager. It is a broadband continuum context imager by itself. Yeah? And this makes it so the VTF is, can be used standalone, so it does not need an extra context imager. But it's also a very good context instrument for the grating spectrographs we have at DKIST, because then the VTF can act as a context imager and as a second polarimeter for maybe a different layer of the solar atmosphere. And this property of being two instruments means it has three of these gigantic detectors, which make it the most data producing instrument of the instrument suite. Yeah? Three 4K by 4K cameras spitting out data. So initially, with the one etalon, we'll provide four of these ultra narrow band pre-filters for the sodium one line, so chromosphere, for the well-known iron line at 630 nanometers, with the Lond effect of 2.5, ideal for the magnetic field measurements. H-alpha, of course, for chromosphere, and infrared calcium line at 854, which is for magnetic field measurements in the interchromosphere. In principle, the VTF can observe any other line between 589 and 854, provided you have a filter for that. Yeah? And I put a suitable pre-filter, and I, in a very small print, I write down what that means. Yeah? It is ultra narrow band. Yeah? So in the red, it is 1.2 angstrom, 1.3 angstrom in width, 60 millimeter clear aperture. Hmm? This is beyond the standard size. Yeah? And therefore, these filters are very expensive. And that's the main reason why we just have four. Because not so long afterwards, say in 2022, we'll have the final version or the next version of the VTF with the two Fabry Perots. Yeah? And then we'll have additional pre-filters, which then have width between 0.3 and 0.7 nanometer. And in the original plan, we have this list of lines, 50 to 525 nanometers. These are two lines with Lond effectors of 3 and 1.5. Yeah? A non-magnetic ion line at 557.6 nanometers. Yeah? And more, the other lines are all strongly magnetic lines for the photosphere. And of course, you can imagine, think of other lines, like helium line at, in the green, which would be an option. Everything. And the filter wheel that we have can hold up to 10 of these filters, so which can be permanently installed and change quickly. Now, what you will find out that sooner or later you are short of photons in the chromosphere. What do you do when you need more photons and want a better signal-to-noise ratio? You use more area on the sun. That means less spatial resolution. You can do that by pixel binning, or you use more wavelength bandwidth, if you can, so with less spectral resolution, or you just integrate longer. We have heard from Sami that for the UV and Sunrise 2, the integration time was 5 minutes, which is certainly not an option for ground-based measurement. Yeah? And in case of the VTF, the spectral resolution is hardwired. That's the FBI, that's the air gap size. Yeah? That gives the spectral resolution. So you cannot easily change that. What you can do is spatial binning, or you change the integration time, or you do more of these repeats. And you also can do spectral undersampling, but of course that does not provide you photons, but it saves you time. In case when you do Doppler measurements, that's an option, because you don't need all the, maybe don't need all the wavelength points. I give you a few numbers, just to make that a little bit clearer. We do have, of course, photons, so it's 600 nanometers. The spectral irradiance is 1.7 watts per square meter and nanometer on the Earth. That translates into 10 to the 18th photons, photons per square meter, nanometer, and second. That sounds all good, 10 to the 18th, that's a lot. But now I should have written diffraction limited on the above the last two columns. The last two columns are for diffraction limited imaging, which makes these columns independent of the telescope. You can write DKIS, you can write Sunrise, you can write HMI, you can write Gregor or whatever you want. It's true for all solar telescopes. And these are the photons per resolution element and per 25 milliseconds. This looks strange. I chose that because that's the integration time for the, that we chose for the VTF. And you still have 500,000 at the entrance of the telescope. But then you have the telescope, you have the beam splitters, you have the VTF, you have the polarimeter, you have the polarizing beam splitter. And in front of the detector, we are down to 50,000. And we then you have the quantum efficiency of your detector. So you have some maybe 40,000 photons. That's in the spectral continuum. And now we talk about signal to noise for a second. That's a good question. I think it's per pixel. I think it's per pixel. And I think it's per pixel. And 40,000 photons or electrons in the detector, that means you have a signal to noise ratio of 200. Square root of 40,000 is 200. And that's it. And that's not enough for polarimetry. This is why we did this 8 accumulations. If you do that for 10 times, then you have 10 times more photons, which unfortunately increases your signal to noise only by a factor of 3. So you get from 200 to something like 600. That's the reason for these repeated observations. And that's true for all telescopes. And I don't think that we need a camera with 100 frames per second for spectropolarimetry, at least not as long as you wish to be diffraction limited. If you give up spatial resolution, you can be, of course, then you gain a lot. This is here, and this, these numbers show you how quickly you can decrease your observation time. The left column, you have different pixel samplings or binning. And then I have spectroscopy without polarimetry, and I have polarimetry with a signal to noise. That's incorrect. It's not SNR. It's the inverse of the signal to noise ratio. It's 0. So that's the wrong headline. But you know what is meant there. And five, so the precision is meant here. So when you increase your pixel size from 10 to 40, you go down from 12 seconds to 2 seconds. But of course, you have lost the advantage of the, well, the resolution of the 4-meter telescope. Then if you go to 40 kilometer pixels, which is still a tenth of an arc second resolution, then you use most of the DKIS as flux collector. Then you have the resolution of a 1-meter telescope, but with 16 times the flux, the photon flux, and also 4 times the signal to noise ratio. I come to a selection of technical challenges. I don't mention all of them, and this is the possibility to give credit to the team who worked on that for the last years or to overcome these. First of all, we needed a polarization modulator with a clear aperture of 60 millimeter. I'll show in the next slide why it is so big. We found one vendor, I should say at most. And so we have now 5 ferroelectric liquid crystals with the same with this size, which are good. So two of them are mounted in the modulator, and there is a set of spares. And the number five actually is not so good. And the company actually was willing to replace it because it was out of spec. And after a year, they gave up. We can't do it anymore, is what they say. Because the raw material, yeah, the liquid crystal stuff, yeah, these pneumatic crystals, they have a new supplier. This is what they tell us. Yeah, and they seem to be of less quality. Yeah? But the good news is we have a pair that works very well, and we have another pair in stock, which also works very well. And FLCs are monochromatic, yeah, to begin with. But fortunately, we have Daniel Giesler at KISS, yeah, who knows how to make a polychromatic modulator out of a pair of FLCs with a pair of retard fixed retarders. Yeah? So we have that, and I'll show you a picture of the and it's working very well. The Fabry-Perot interferometers, they, in our case, have to have a clear aperture of 25 centimeters, and they have to be good in terms of flatness of the substrates, or in constancy of the air gap between the two plates, and they have to be very smooth. And in addition, these big things have to be very precisely tuned. And after a while, many years ago, we realized there were no vendors for such a thing. We thought there were one or two in the world that could do it. But so we were left with a huge development effort involving involving several companies and the KISS team. So it's Saigo Amatec here in the United States. It's a company called LMR, Laboratoire de Matériaux Avancés in Lyon, in France. Physics Instrumente in Germany, and also Heidenhain in Germany. And all of them had their contribution to this development. One question that came to my mind is, why are these so big? Why the hell, what drives the size of the Fabry-Perot and others? Actually, it's these very reasonable requirements. Yeah? We have a 4-meter telescope, and of course, we want diffraction-limited imaging, and which means we want to do at least critical sampling with pixels. And now I come to the instrument field of view. We want at least 60 arcsecond field of view. And these, the telescope aperture, the desire to do diffraction-limited imaging, and the 60 arc seconds field of view, that create the 250 millimeter Fabry-Perot. Because diffraction-limited imaging means the instrument must not contribute to the diffraction, must not limit the resolution. And it would limit the resolution when you employ smaller Fabry-Perots, because then you have something which is called pupil apodization, which I will not explain now, but it would exist, yeah, if you have a fast beam going through the interferometer. So you want to have a very slow beam, which is f over 200 or 160. And a slow beam is a big beam. And this drives you. And the same with the same chain of arguments, you find out why the prefilters are so large, yeah, and why the polarization modulator is so large. Yeah. Because, well, there's one thing in addition. You don't want to put the modulator or the prefilter in a pupil image, which could be smaller. But the quality of these devices is not, the optical quality is not good enough. You want to have them close to a focal plane. And that means the field of view and the pixel size tells you how large these things are. Once again, the challenges for the Fabry-Perots, it's the size, the flatness, the micro roughness, and the tuning precision. And the tuning precision means we want to change the wavelength in steps of 3 picometers. This is 2 steps per resolution element. The spectral resolution is 6 picometers. And 3 picometers wavelength change corresponds to 3 nanometer mechanical movement. I know that our mechanical engineers, they sat back and say, are you kidding? Yeah? Do you have the wrong dimension here? Yeah? Shouldn't that be micrometers? No, it's nanometers. It's and that is the was the big one of the big challenges. And in addition, it's and all of them have to be met. Otherwise, we won't have a good instrument. Flatness and smoothness can be easy. For example, for a smooth coating, you do physical vapor deposition, sputtering, hard coatings. Yeah? This is when you have ions that are brought to the substrate over with a strong field at high speed. Yeah? So you, and this gives you a perfectly flat surface, perfectly smooth coating. But with this high speed at high temperature, the atoms are overdense. So this is a layer of, say, 3 microns. But the after the sputtering process, the atoms are too close together. They are not in equilibrium. And the atoms, they sense that. And after a while, they decide, I want to go back to my equilibrium position. And start to, so the coating expands, which doesn't play a role in the 3 micron thickness. But in the lateral, along the substrate, the coating either separates from the substrate, which you don't want, or it takes the substrate with it. Means it bends the substrate. Not too much, but in our case, it would be about 80, 100 nanometers bending, which is too much because you have two plates, and one of them is like this, and the other one is like this. Yeah? And because you have the same coating of both on two plates yeah, facing each other, and then you don't have an interferometer anymore. That means you have to avoid that. The classical solution is don't do that. Use soft coatings, chemical vapor deposition coatings. They have, so the ions fall onto the substrate. There is no such thing which we call compressive stress. But they are rough. They are not very smooth. Yeah? We decided we want the smoothness yeah? because we need it, because that's part of the spectral resolution. And so, and there is the obvious remedy is you just use a very thick substrate. This is what LIGO did. You know the LIGO interferometers for the gravitational waves? They have been made at the same companies, by the way, just shortly before our project started. And LIGO, they use substrate they are this high and this thickness, yeah? About half a meter thick. They don't bend. But that just was not an option for the VTF because we want to send light through these things. And not only that, that would not be the big problem. We want to move them in steps of 3 nanometers. Yeah? And so we have 10 plates that have a thickness of 10 centimeters, yeah? Which weigh 20 kilograms. Excuse me? Yes. Yeah? Not only that, you want to slightly move the elephant up and down. So we are limited to something like 10 centimeters, and we have this bending. And we have a solution. The solution is called coating stress compensation. And that's something the companies want to have patented. And this is why I don't talk too much about it today. And the background is you just put additional layers to get rid of the effect up and down. There's, because they have the possibility, there is layers which have this compressive stress, which are overdense. But there is other coatings which have the tensile stress, yeah, which do this, the opposite, have the opposite behavior, that upon cooling, the coating shrinks. Yeah, and so they would exert stress in the other, in the opposite orientation. And a combination of these things is what we have done, and it works. Yeah. I just show you, this is a picture of the instrument, of the one of the plates in the interferometer. Here you see some, here you see the, here, this is one of the interferometer substrates at SIGO with a handling tool. Here is now it's inside this holder, this metal frame for measurements. And here is the result. So actually, they did it. We have flatness with an RMS of half a nanometer, which is excellent. So all the bending has gone. And perfect. By the way, we put the interferometer, what I call horizontal. Right? The opticians call it vertical because the beam is vertical. But plates are horizontal, and that means there is some gravity influence. That is not important, because the gravity is the same for both plates. And that means that there is a slight curvature of the air gap, radius of hundreds of meters. That is not important. Important is that the air gap has the same size everywhere. And now we are at half a nanometer, which is really excellent. And the micro roughness, which was supposed to be good because of the process that has been chosen, is also excellent. The picture shows the one of the plates for the first Fabry Perot now coated. You see here the shiny 250 millimeter coating. Actually, the coating, I think, is 260 millimeters, because the beam is 250 millimeter. And the micro roughness is 0.2 nanometers, or 2 angstrom, which is also excellent. Both numbers are about an order of magnitude better than what we have with our small interferometers in our old instrument at the VTT. So this 0.2 nanometers will make an excellent interferometer out of these plates. To 0.2 nanometer across 25 centimeters is equivalent to Lake Michigan having a water surface with waves of less than 0.1 millimeters all over the lake. So it needs a really calm day. And no wave excitation. And by the way, the flatness of these substrates of half a nanometer is flatter than, say, a bucket of mercury. Because the curvature of Earth across 25 centimeters is already 4 nanometers. So the gravity of Earth, and the shape of the Earth, shows up over 25 centimeters as a curvature of 4 nanometers. Tuning precision, I mentioned that already, and that had been a cooperation between the vendors of equipment, PE for the piezo actuators, Heidenheim for the optical encoders, and engineers at our institute who actually wrote the control software to do that, to move the Edelong plates in steps of 3 nanometers with a precision of, say, a tenth of that. So which is now we are talking about picometer, hundreds of picometer precision. And then the lower right, you see here a measurement in closed loop, so without moving. So there is no step shown here. And you see the plate separation is kept constant on a scale of about a tenth of a nanometer, 150 picometer. And that's the size of a lithium atom. So yeah, and they can do steps. Now controlled steps, and the settling times are in the meantime in the right range. Because having it idle in the same place is one thing, but stepping this 20 kilogram, 3 nanometers up or 3 nanometers down, and you don't want to wait forever, because we want to be, after all, fast. What you see here in the figure on the left, you see here 2 out of 6 encoders, 3 pairs of encoders, because we measure the upper and the lower plate to avoid differential effects. We measure both the motion of both plates, because when you move the upper plate up, of course there's a force on the support structure, so the lower plate may go down at the same time, or will. This is why we measure the location of both plates and use the differential signal of both actuators, both encoders, to control the actuator movement. While we speak, the Edelong or the Fabry Perot is being assembled in the laboratory in Freiburg. And you see the top left, you see again one of the interferometer plates. This is not perfectly round, this has cutouts. This is the room for the piezo actuators. And on the drawings on the right, they show the housing and the earthquake protection and things like that. And in the bottom row, you see a dummy we built a full-size aluminum dummy of the Etalon, where we did everything. So because this has never been done before by our people, and so and each of these interferometer plates, they are a little bit more than half a million in euro, huh? Plus 2 years delivery time.
Yeah,
and so they wanted to train themselves. Yeah. And they wanted to train everything, the gluing, the positioning, the handling, the rotating. And actually, they also developed the software on this dummy. Here is the modulator assembly. And just wanted to show you a little bit of hardware here. So the instrument is being built up right now. I think this is not nude. I think this is 2 months old, this picture. In the meantime, I think all the mechanics is installed and optics will be installed very, very soon. Yeah? Here you see camera mounts and filter wheels. So filter was not enough E. And I wanted to mention the operational aspects. Yeah? Most of the users of the VTF will never see the instrument. Yeah? The only thing that you will see is this one, that we will see a screen, yeah? Which the instrument performance calculator. And this contains everything that our instrument can do. So you can set up your observation, choosing lines, choosing scan mode, choosing binning, choosing whatever you can. And there is the different modes of operation, Stokes or Doppler or monochromatic, where you don't scan. And then we have also different levels of expertise. If you are a newcomer in the field, you use the default settings. Yeah? Then you blame others, yeah? When it doesn't work. Yeah? And or you say, oh, no, I know what I do. I use at least the basic mode where you have more flexibility. Or you want to do a discovery. You want to use a mode nobody else uses. Then you have the is advanced mode, which has the disadvantage that then you are on your own. Then you may have to do the calibration also yourself, because the data calibration pipeline is only for default and for basic operations, for the controlled and well-tested modes, I should say. Yeah, and so this is probably what all of the observers will see. And the page tells you how much data you will produce, how much data, what the data rate will be, which is of interest for the people on the mountain, and how long it will take, and so on. And you see it as simulated line profile. So that should be helpful. You can export the data from this, and actually this could be sent to the operators or to the engineering GUI. I don't know if that actually will happen, but it could. And actually the engineering GUI is actually connected to the instrument via what they call OPC, UA, this Open Platform Communication Protocol, which actually translates our wishes into machine-readable language. Yeah, and this is one of the last slides of the first part. Second part is very short. And Thomas has shown the milestones or the schedule, and we didn't talk to each other, but I'm glad to see that this fits together, doesn't it? Yeah? So the green arrow says ready for science, yeah? In the second quarter of next year. Yeah? So this is at least what I hear from our team. Yeah? And the other rows show what's going on right now. We are assembling the FBI. We are assembling the instrument. We will do lab testing, or the team will do a lot of lab testing. Packing and shipping takes time. We learn that it takes longer than you think. And then there is a relatively short time foreseen for integration and verification. We'll see whether that's sufficient. And since the VTF is the last instrument to be installed, I think at least on the DCAS side, there will be a lot of experience of integrating new instruments into the telescope and observatory environment. I'm only the reporter today. Yeah? Here you see not the names, but the faces of people who are involved in making this happen in Freiburg, but also on Haleakala. Yeah? I should mention that in order to be prepared to set up the instrument, yeah, we prepare the QD lab. Yeah? there is already a dummy version of the base frame, which has exactly the same dimensions as the one we have in Freiburg. Yeah? So we will remove the dummy and we'll install the instrument, and that's at least the theory. Yeah? It should immediately fit, and which is good because it penetrates through the Coudet platform, so it has to fit, yeah? But it will. Yeah, that's all I have to say about the VTF for today. Thank you very much.